Let us start this evening with one decade of the Rosary. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen. Let us contemplate the fifth glorious mystery, the coronation of Our Lady. And let us imagine Our Lady in heaven with our Lord Jesus crowning her, the crown of 12 stars, and all the angels and saints bowing low before her, honoring her and loving her. And we can even imagine ourselves there, maybe taken there by our angels as a, or just an outsider looking into heaven, and we can see the great dignity of Our Lady and all the heavenly court, angels and saints, honoring her and loving her, and maybe even the souls in purgatory seeing Our Lady's coronation and also bowing down in honor of their queen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost. O my Jesus, forgive us our sins, save us from the fires of hell, and lead all souls to heaven, especially those in most need of thy mercy. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen. So I'd like to welcome everybody back to this, the third conference on De Montfort's True Devotion. So now we've got the diehards here, so people who are going to stick with it, although we shouldn't just say that. So everybody should be working through this book right now, or the Spanish one. This is the prayer book. The chart is on the front, in the front. If you didn't start it, it's okay. Start it. If you've missed a day, don't worry about it. Do it. Just do it. Just do it. Don't worry. We'll talk a little more about this. Some of the difficulties that you'll encounter. So, just a brief review. Remember, chapter 1, De Montfort talks about the necessity of devotion to Our Lady. He says, it's not optional, it's not a good idea, it's not something nice, it's all those things, but it's necessary. And he shows why it's necessary, because Mary has a unique place in heaven. She's the daughter of God the Father, the mother of God the Son, and the spouse of the Holy Spirit. And because of that, God then, in his plan, has her be the sort of channel by which we go to him. He came to us through Mary, and we return to him through Mary. In a sense, he set her up as the mediatrix of all graces. She's the mediatrix of all graces two ways. First of all, because she did say yes to God and became the mother of God, so she brought Christ into the world that way. But then also at the foot of the cross, I don't think I've talked about this before, at least at these talks, she won the grace through her suffering. At the foot of the cross, she won the grace for everybody. A little bit different than the way Christ won it, but she won it also. So she's the mediatrix two ways. She's sort of remote in the sense that she brought Christ into the world and Christ won our salvation on Calvary. Usually, like, Protestants don't have a problem with that. It's the second one that gets them a little nervous to say, she merited our salvation at the foot of the cross, along with Christ. She's the co-redemptrix with Christ. It would be nothing without Christ. She didn't do it on her own. And if Christ wasn't there, her merit and suffering would be nothing. It wouldn't be effective. It's only added to Christ. So, she is necessary because of her unique role in our salvation. And then in chapter 2, he talks a little about how the marks of different marks, like the different types of false devotees, and various things. I'm not gonna cover it right now, because that should be fresh in the memory from last week. So we will finish chapter 2 this week, and then also do chapter 3. Now chapter 3 is pretty short, so we'll probably get through chapter 3. So we'll just do those two. So, the marks of authentic devotion to Our Lady, which is where we let off last time, which is paragraph 105. Okay, after having explained and condemned false devotions to the Blessed Virgin Mary, we shall now briefly describe what true devotion is. It is interior, trustful, holy, constant, and disinterested. Okay, it's interior. It's not just exterior. We, you know, the Pharisees were interested in exterior things, and that was it. They liked to do exterior practices so people could look at them and think, oh, look at how holy they are. Whereas interiorly, they had nothing there. And so all devotion has to start in the interior, and then the exterior should flow from that interior. If we just do things to look good, that's called being a Pharisee, called being a hypocrite. That you shouldn't do. So, it is interior first, and then it flows to the exterior. It is trustful, that is, we have confidence in Our Lady. We turn to her for everything, consoled in trials, and for her to help our body and soul. And this is, I think, when we think about Mary as our mother, it's very easy to then think about how a little child, again, a five-year-old child, you always have to go to before the age of reason, and then think about a little child, and then you gotta just think about them without their naughtiness. You know, you gotta take that away. And then you always have a perfect model there, or a very good model, of what our spiritual life is. So, just like a little child, just trust his parents, trust his mother, almost perfectly. So, we, or a mark of authentic devotion, trust Our Lady. You know, I'm reminded of a movie. There was a movie out a few years ago. I can't remember the name of it exactly. Into the Great Silence, or Into Great Silence. So it was a movie about the Carthusians at the Grand Chartreuse Monastery in France. For those of you who aren't familiar with it, the Carthusians are the most hardest, it's the most difficult of all the monastic life. And they're the ones that sometimes popularly they think they have a vow of not speaking. Well, they don't have a vow, but they don't speak very much. They only speak to each other like once a week or something like that. And this movie maker approached them and said, "Can I make a movie about your life?" And this is an order that, as you can imagine, does not make decisions rashly. And so they said, "Well, let us get back to you." And of course, 16 years later, they said to him, "I think you can make that movie. We've talked about it. You can make that movie." So he made the movie. Now, the director, and I can't remember his name, but he was not a good practicing Catholic, from what I understand. And he lived in the monastery, I think, for about 9 or 10 months. He was there for a large chunk of time, left, then was able to go back in. And after, of course, the movie came out, and I'm sure many of you have seen it, someone asked him. He said, "What impressed you most about the brothers, about the life there?" And he is reported to have said, "They were like little children, in a sense, just trusting God for everything. They were like little children." If you think about it, like these 60-year-old, 70-year-old monks who have been there for 50 years, they just had that simplicity, and this director could see it. And that, our saint says, De Montfort says, is a mark of true devotion. That simplicity, that trustfulness. Another mark of authentic devotion, the third one, is holy. It leads us to avoid sin and imitate the virtues of Mary. Remember, she is the perfect disciple. She is Christ's first disciple and His perfect disciple. So our devotion to her should lead us to imitate her. Now, I think I said this last time. Sometimes people think, "Well, I need to work on my spiritual life for a few years, maybe another year, before I make the consecration." No. The devotion, the consecration itself, is a way in which you become holy. It helps you to be more holy. And so, this is one of the marks. It helps us to grow in holiness. It leads us to avoid sin and imitate the virtues of Mary, her sanctification of the soul. Remember in the first chapter, we imitate Mary. The more we imitate Mary, the more the virtue we have, the virtues of Mary in us, which are the true Christian virtues, the more the Holy Ghost dwells within us, the more the Holy Ghost dwells within us, the more Christ is present in our life. And this, of course, is holiness. We become more like God. Holiness, maybe we should back up. Holiness is what? Holiness is being like God, we say. No, it's not being God, but it's our sort of conformity, our unity. We say, "Holy, holy, holy. Lord God Almighty." The angels say that, right? We say it at Mass. The choir sings it. And then holiness, sanctification, is to become like God. Become holy. So, the more we have the Holy Spirit, Christ, dwelling within us, the holier we are. And so this devotion helps us to be holy. Leads us to holiness. True devotion is constant. Does not give up devotional practices easily. Remember, there are three things that we fight against. As St. Paul says, the world, the flesh, and the devil. The world, the flesh, and the devil. Not every temptation comes from the devil. But he does tempt us. The world, that is society, and the things of the world tempt us. And then our own, from ourselves, our own flesh tempts us to sin. And so we fight against this. And our devotion helps us to fight against these temptations against sin. We're constant in fighting against them. So when we're tempted more, we just continue to do our devotions. When we're tempted less and things are going great, we continue to do that. We can also look at this in terms of consolation. When we get a lot of consolation, we pray, it's easy to pray, it's really enjoyable to pray. Sometimes we want to add extra prayers. But then when it becomes difficult, don't feel like praying, go through what they say a dry period, the temptation is to drop off of devotions. Right? It's a spiritual, it's one of the rules of spirituality. God initially gives us a lot of consolation in the beginning, and then after a while he removes that consolation as we grow spiritually. Why? Because he wants us to love him. He doesn't want us to love the way he makes us feel. So you see this all the time with new converts or something. Someone's on fire for about 2 years and they get excited about every devotion, and then things kind of slow down. They get in the dumps a little bit. They no longer get the excitement out of prayer that they used to get. And that is a natural progression in the spiritual life. God removes his consolation, and then things get difficult. And what our saint is saying is, it doesn't matter whether we're flying high or whether it's really difficult, our devotion is constant. Constant. Let me see here. So, I want to add something here, just talk about something really, really quickly. And that is about this consolation and desolation. And just about this kind of feelings, things like that. And this really isn't here, but I'm just going to add this as a little extra thing. Because whenever I talk about this, I'm always reminded of a certain thing that someone once related to me. There was a person. I'll tell this here. Okay. Little sidetrack here. Okay. So, there was a guy, he once told me something that happened to him. And he said, one time he was praying, and he had really bad eyesight. And he was praying really fervently one night, and it just seemed like things were just clicking. He was just praying and praying and praying for a few hours. He kind of lost track of time. And one of the things he asked for was that God would heal his eyesight. Because he really didn't like, he thought it was a real difficulty, a real cross. So he prayed late into the night. And then crawled into bed, went to sleep. And in the morning he woke up. And for those of you who wear glasses, you know exactly what I mean, or at least are nearsighted. First thing you do when you wake up is you push the snooze button, right? No. You reach for your glasses because you can't see anything. And this gentleman said, I woke up, I opened my eyes, I could see. I didn't have to reach for my glasses. And it was incredible. He said I got on my knees and I began to pray. And this was before I went to the seminary, but he told me this. He said, Father, didn't call me Father. It was the most wonderful experience I ever had. I could feel God's love just washing over me. And my prayers were were so, so perfect, so enjoyable, so wonderful. And as I was praying there, thanking God for this miracle, I began to well up. My eyes started welling up, and the tears started forming. And I began to weep. And as the tears rolled down, began to roll down my face, I felt something in my eyes. And I started blinking. And I blinked some more. And I reached up. And I realized that I had went to bed with my contact lenses in. He said, all of a sudden, all those wonderful feelings, all that wonderful consolation just kind of disappeared. And he learned a valuable lesson that we shouldn't trust our senses. Don't trust our senses. For that was, of course, an extreme example, but the consolation that man was feeling was from himself. It wasn't from God. And yet he said it was one of the most wonderful things he ever experienced. At least we'll say in the morning. Maybe that night it wasn't, but in the morning. And so the point is that we need to be careful. Sometimes people only do their devotions when they feel like it. They enjoy the good feeling, or maybe I shouldn't say feel like it. They do them because they enjoy the consolation they get, that good feeling they get. And we want to be aware of that. That oftentimes, sometimes, I don't know, it's from ourselves. And we shouldn't do our prayers for that reason. I think last time I talked about St. Ignatius, he said, when you're feeling great, the temptation is, when you get a lot of consolation, the temptation is to add more and more devotions. And then when you're down in the dumps, you don't want to do them. You get rid of them all. Devotion, true devotion is constant. You do your devotion, and whether it's great, whether it's difficult, you just do it. Just do it. Why? Because you're devoted to Our Lady. You're not devoted to yourself for the good feeling. You're devoted to Mary. Okay, one other thing he says is, and this is an important point, that sometimes people might think, well, if I'm truly devoted to Our Lady, I'm never going to sin. And he says, don't be fooled by that. We're all sinners, so don't. That's a little trap of the devil. Don't fall into that. Now, we don't want to say that it's a good thing to sin, but I'll just read what he says. We do not say, however, that such a person never sins, or that his sensible feelings of devotion never change. When he has fallen, he stretches out his hand to his Blessed Mother and rises again. And we'll just leave it at that. Okay. Fifth, true devotion to Mary is disinterested. That is, it's not self-centered. Why don't we put it that way? We're not doing this to get something for ourselves. Remember, the one of the false devotions are the people who are only interested in getting things for themselves, who only turn to Jesus and Mary when they're in trouble. I think I talked about someone who was like that way. I gave a little example. But it's disinterested. So this is the contrary of that. We are devoted to Our Lady. Why? Because she is lovable in herself, for herself. And whether we get great graces or not, our devotion is not self-interested. We love her for her. Now, there's a danger here, and I want to just make a little caveat. He doesn't mention it. But there is the danger of what we call quietism, and this notion that we should never, ever, ever ever like desire anything for ourselves. This is the belief that we shouldn't even desire heaven. No, he's not saying that. He's not saying that. He's just saying that we shouldn't be devoted to Our Lady just to get things for ourselves. Okay? We're devoted to Our Lady because she is, he says it right there. He loves her not so much because she is good to him or because he expects something from her, but simply because she is lovable. And this is why he loves and serves her just as faithfully in weariness and dryness of soul as in sweet and sensible fervor. And this we can turn to what we would think is a good marriage. Husband and wife love each other, and their love is should be disinterested. And yes, the other person will love them back. And that's true. And just like our love of Our Lady, she'll love us back. And she will take care of us. But that shouldn't be the reason, the foundation for our love of her. And I think if we think about like a good, healthy marriage, that's kind of an analogy, not perfect, but similar. That the spouses love each other in a sort of disinterested way. I've lost my notes. Let me get my notes here. Okay, so he ends this section. Those are the five, what he says, marks of true devotion, authentic devotion to Our Lady. And then he ends this section, he ends this chapter. I'm sorry, he ends this section with another little prophecy. Remember he prophesied before at the end of chapter 1 about the super saints that will come. However, this prophecy is a little different. He does talk about the saints in the future in paragraph 113. However, 114. I clearly see that raging beasts will come in fury to tear to pieces with their diabolical teeth this little book and the one the Holy Spirit made use to write it, or they will cause it to lie hidden in the darkness and silence of a chest, so as to prevent it from seeing the light of day. Okay. Now, if you have our book, both versions both have a little footnote here. And that is, that prophecy came true literally. For De Montfort died in 1716. So this book was written in the early 1700s. But it wasn't found till, well, we'll look at the footnote. It was discovered in 1842, so it was missing. It was lost for 130 years, at least. And then it was not published till 1843. So he had, it was a little prophecy, he saw it. And it was lost in a trunk, as he says, will cause it to lie hidden in the darkness and silence of a chest, so as to prevent it from seeing the light of day. And it was only found by one of his Montfort fathers, apparently found it in a chest after the French Revolution, and then caused it to be published. However, the second part of this prophecy is more for us. They, meaning the raging beasts, will even attack and persecute those who read it and put into practice what it contains. But no matter, so much the better. It even gives me encouragement to hope for great success at the prospect of a mighty legion of brave and valiant soldiers of Jesus and Mary, both men and women, who will fight the devil, the world, and corrupt nature in the perilous times that are sure to come. Let the reader understand, let him accept this teaching who can. So, makes a little prophecy about us, for we're reading this. This is one of the reasons why I'm giving this talk in the church, in the presence of the Blessed Sacrament. This is why we start with a decade of the Rosary. Because the devil will attack us to try to stop us from reading this, from understanding this. Now, I need to make it clear, this is not going to be like a Hollywood exorcist movie, you know, the bed flying up around and things like that. Not that kind of attack. But it will be a moral attack, the way he normally operates. He's going to try to distract us. He's going to try to confuse you. I remember one time, a priest was giving a talk in a church, and the boiler broke. The church was ice cold. They figured it was the devil. The thing worked perfectly before. Afterwards, seemed to work fine. But it was interesting. It didn't work for that talk. He wants people not to hear this. He wants you to not read this. You know, sometimes people read the book here, and they don't understand it. They say, Father, I have no idea what is going on. I read it, but I don't understand it. And this was taught to me by someone else, someone who also was a devotee of St. Louis Marie de Montfort. And this person said, when that happens, you get on your knees and you read it on your knees. And you'll be surprised. You'll be able to understand it better. And I know there are people who that has happened. They couldn't understand it. It was confusing or something. And when they got on their knees on the side of their bed and they read it, they said they could understand it better. And the only thing I could say is that was just the devil, just confusing them a little bit. And that by getting on your knees is a way of honoring Our Lady, and she gives the graces. Now, I mentioned before, you know, the book, Our Daily Prayers for the Consecration. You know, I said, if you miss a day, keep going. Because the devil's going to try to distract you from this. He's going to try to make you forget. You're going to think about it, and you're going to think, oh, you know, I want to do my prayers, but, you know, I got to check my email. You know, I gotta do that laundry that I've been putting off for 3 days. It's just I gotta do it right now. And that's another type of attack from the devil. It tries to distract us. Sometimes when you have something spiritual to do, all of a sudden you get very productive. You start doing all the things that you know you should have done a while ago. Sometimes that's ourselves, but we should also realize that the devil is trying to stop us from doing this. If you miss a day, sometimes I've talked to people and they've missed a day and they said, oh, Father, you know, I missed a day and now it's all wrecked. You know, I gotta wait till the next day on the chart, don't I? And that's when, July 13th, and no. If you miss a day, just do it. Just do it. I have met very few people who have done this consecration for the first time perfectly. That is, they did every day at the right time in order. I've met very few people. There are people who, after they did it the first time, they were able to do it the second time and the third time and the fourth time. But the first time is the hardest. Why? Because the devil is going to attack us. Why is that? Why is that? Because it's Genesis 3:15. I'll put enmity between you and the woman, between her seed and your seed. We are her seed. In the book of the Apocalypse, when we see, I wish I had my Bible here, when we have the vision, St. John has the vision of Our Lady giving birth to Christ. It's not exactly a vision of that. I should have said it a little differently, but there's a vision of the woman, we'll say, giving birth to Christ. Because it's not a vision of the nativity. I just want to make that clear. So then the dragon can't attack the child. The child is placed in a place where the dragon can't attack it. If you read the Apocalypse, I should have it here, but I don't. And it says, so he goes to make war on the woman's other children. That's us, especially those who make the consecration. He's going to try to stop you from doing it. He's going to try to stop you. It's not going to be like a movie, The Exorcist, or anything. But he's just going to try to confuse you, distract you, and tell you it's not worth it. Okay, so don't fall into that trap. Okay, let's continue. The principal practices of devotion to Our Lady. And he just goes through a list here. There are several interior practices of true devotion to the Blessed Virgin Mary. Here briefly are the main ones, and he gives 12 of them. Honoring her as the worthy Mother of God by the cult of hyperdulia. Now, hyperdulia. I don't know if everyone knows what that exactly means, but we'll go over that. Don't worry about it. It's not difficult. Some of you might remember from like your catechism. There's dulia, latria, and then hyperdulia, but not in that order. So we give God latria, that is true worship and adoration to God. Dulia, though, is the honor which we give to the saints. They've gone before us. They've been found worthy. They've been followers of Christ. Sometimes they've performed miracles. So we honor them and we love them. But we don't honor and love them in the same way that we honor God and love God. God, we give latria. The saints, we give dulia. But when we think about it, we say, well, but Our Lady is a little different than any of the other saints. So we give her something a little bit different than the rest of the saints, and that is called hyperdulia. Hyper means above in Greek. Hyperdulia. It's above the dulia, but not latria. So that's all that means. In case you forgot what that meant. So it's just honoring her with the cult that is, well, you know, the dignity of hyperdulia. That is, and then he gives kind of like a little definition. Esteeming and honoring her more than all the other saints, and as the masterpiece of grace and the foremost in holiness after Jesus Christ, true God and true man. Okay. Also, meditating upon her virtues, privileges, and actions, contemplating her sublime dignity. These are our principal practices. Offering her acts of love, invoking her with a joyful heart, offering ourselves to her and uniting ourselves to her, doing everything to please her. Okay, and then number 8 is the big one. Beginning, carrying out, and contemplating our actions through her, in her, with her, and for her, in order to do them through Jesus, in Jesus, with Jesus, and for Jesus, our last end. We shall explain this last practice later. So, he's given us a little foreshadowing. This is now, that number 8, that last one, is part of his devotion. And he'll talk about it later. We do everything with Mary, for Mary, in Mary, and through her. So that we can do them through Jesus, in Jesus, with Jesus, and for Jesus. So again, it's to Jesus through Mary, and he'll explain what he means about that later. It's later on in the book. It'll be, I think, in 2 weeks. So, devotion to Our Lady also has several exterior practices. Here are the principal ones, and here he enumerates 12. Enrolling in her confraternities and her sodalities, joining religious orders dedicated to her, and that could be like a third order, like the Third Order of Carmelites or something like that. You can join them in her honor. Making her privileges known and appreciated, that is preaching about her, or at least maybe not preaching, but telling other people about it. Giving alms, fasting, and performing interior and exterior acts of self-denial in her honor. Reciting the rosary. And then he gives a number of other things. A rosary of the 6 or 7 decades, a little crown of the Blessed Virgin Mary, which is in the back of the book here. Reciting the office, the little office of Our Lady, the little Psalter of the Blessed Virgin Mary, and things like that. A number of other different devotions. Singing hymns to her and teaching others to sing them. Then he has genuflecting to her 60 or 100 times in the morning. Taking charge of her confraternities, decorating her altars, and crowning and adorning her statues. carrying statues in procession, having statues made of her, having her name engraved and placed on the walls of churches, houses, and the gates of entrances of towns, churches, and houses. That's a devotion that you don't hear much about. I wanted to mention that a little bit. The Holy Name of Mary. The Holy Name of Mary. Everybody knows about the Holy Name of Jesus. There's also the Holy Name of Mary. And there's a feast for the Holy Name of Mary also. It's in September. It is said, I'll change it, just a little story here again. So, St. Faustina. Now I'm going to change the story again. Okay, I'm going to give you the same story, but I'm figuring out how I'm going to do it here. All right, I practiced this, and I was going to do it one way, but now I'm changing. I'm not doing it the way I thought I would. Okay. So the Holy Name of Mary is, of course, a great name. We call upon Mary, and we pray to her. And her name has a special power. You know, it's like a prayer. We shouldn't be superstitious about this. It's like calling upon the name of Jesus when we're troubled or just for honoring and loving. And this is why he talks about having the name engraved over city gates or over your door or something like that. Now, Blessed Faustina, Saint Faustina, sorry, when she had a vision of hell, she said one of the things she noticed, I don't know if noticed is the right word, but she saw, was that there was this great cacophony, this great noise. She said it was just the blasphemies from all those there, just cursing God, cursing Jesus. Now I'm going to add something else from what other saints have said. Said that God will allow the devils and the souls in hell to curse his name, to curse him. But he will not allow them to blaspheme the name of Mary. They cannot blaspheme her. They want to, but he won't let them do it. Why? Because it's a special honor that God gives her and her name. And so when we think about that, think about, you know, if God gives her this special privilege, her name, then, you know, we should also imitate that. We can give it a special privilege and honor. And this is the foundation, in a sense, of devotion to the Holy Name of Mary. And then number 12, exterior practices, talks about solemnly giving oneself to her by a special consecration. And this is his devotion that he's going to talk about. Let's see. Time is quickly getting away from me. We haven't even gotten to chapter 3 yet. Have we? Yes, we have. Okay, good. Sorry. Okay, we're doing fine on time. So, that is solemnly giving oneself to her by special consecration. Now, these devotions, he says, there are four ways or four principles that we have to watch when we do them. We have to have the right intention of pleasing God alone, seeking union with Christ as our last end, and giving edification to our neighbor. So again, there it is. Christ is the last end. We do not do our devotion to Mary, to end at Mary, but we end with Christ. We do our devotions with attention, avoiding willful distractions. If distractions come, you push them out, and you keep going. But as soon as you will them, you kneel down and you say, I want to think about whatever. I'm going to think about what I'm going to cook for dinner or what I'm going to do here or something. Then that's a big problem. That's a sin. Okay? A willful distraction. If it just comes into your mind, and they always come into our minds, it's okay. You just push them out when you realize it. We do our devotion, we do them with devotion, that is avoiding haste and negligence. We just don't race through them. You want to do them properly. And he says, with decorum, respectful of bodily posture. So, I need to stand up straight here. So, we do them properly. We kneel down if we're able to kneel. Don't just jump into bed and do your rosary in bed or something like that. You know, our Lord says you can pray in any posture or something. No. We want to have proper decorum. And so those are good principles for any type of devotion, for our actions here at Mass or anything. So those are just general. And then he talks about the perfect practice. And this is, of course, his devotion that he is teaching. And I'll read him here, paragraph 118. Okay, having read nearly every book on devotion to the Blessed Virgin and talked to the most saintly and learned people of the day, I can now state with conviction that I have never known or heard any devotion to Our Lady which is comparable to the one I am going to speak of. Okay. So, gives us again a little foreshadowing of what he's going to talk about. Finally, no devotion gives more glory to God, is more sanctifying for ourselves, or more helpful to our neighbor. Paragraph 119. This devotion essentially consists in a state of the soul. It will not be understood in the same way by everyone. Now, what he means by that is not a good thing. He means not everybody's going to understand it, basically. He said, some, the great majority, will stop short of the threshold and go no further. They're not going to understand it. They're not going to enter into this devotion. Others, many, will take one step into its interior. Who will take the second step? Who will take a third? Finally, who will remain in it permanently? Only the one to whom the Spirit of Jesus reveals the secret. The Holy Spirit himself will lead the faithful soul from strength to strength, from grace to grace, from light to light, until he attains transformation into Jesus in the fullness of his age on earth and his glory in heaven. What does he mean by that? Means, again, not everybody's going to understand the devotion he's talking about. You know, there's that saying, our Lord talks about it. Do not cast your pearls before swine. Why? Because they will trample them, and then they will turn and they will attack you. So some holy things, we don't talk to some people because they're not going to understand it. They will ridicule the devotion, true devotion to the Blessed Virgin Mary. They will ridicule it. Why? Because they won't understand it. He says, some souls, though, will. And those are the ones who the Holy Spirit then enlightens and helps them so that they can become holy. They can be imitators of Christ. All right. Oh, good grief. All right. It always takes longer to cover this stuff. Okay. Than I think it does. Okay, we're on chapter 3. The perfect consecration to Jesus Christ. A complete consecration to Mary. So again, Christ is our end, and we do it through Mary. And I'll just read this again from 120. Now of all God's creatures, Mary is the most conformed to Jesus. It therefore follows that of all devotions, devotion to her makes us the most effective consecration and conformity to him. The more one is consecrated to Mary, the more one is consecrated to Jesus. Again, that same principle comes up. Mary is Christ's perfect disciple. The more we imitate her, the more we are consecrated to her, the more we are a better disciple to Christ. Let's put it in my words. Okay. This devotion, 121. This devotion consists in giving oneself entirely. Now remember, he's finally telling us what his devotion is. He hasn't told us that yet. He's just kind of teased us a couple times, saying, He'll reveal it in the future. This devotion consists in giving oneself entirely to Mary in order to belong entirely to Jesus through her. It requires us to give, number one, our body with all its senses and members. Number two, our soul with all its faculties. Number three, our present material possessions and all that we shall acquire in the future. And number four, our interior and spiritual possessions, that is, our merits, virtues, and good actions of the past, the present, and the future. In other words, we give her all we possess, both in our natural life and our spiritual life, as well as everything we shall acquire in the future, in the order of nature and grace and the glory of holiness. We do this without any reservation. And for all eternity, without claiming or expecting in return for our offering and our service any other reward than the honor of belonging to our Lord through Mary, in Mary, and even though our mother were not, as in fact she always is, the most generous and appreciative of all God's creatures. Okay, I was going to end it halfway through that paragraph, but I had to continue and with that ending part. So we give everything to her, no strings attached. Put it in a little modern language there. No strings attached. We give it to her. However, he says, we do realize that she, of course, is the most generous of all of God's creatures. So even though we give everything to her, of course, she's going to take care of us. We won't be left destitute. We won't be left without anything that we need. She'll take care of us. And he says, even though we know that, even though our mother were not, as she is, the most generous and appreciative of all of God's creatures, so if we give her everything, she will greatly appreciate that. She's the most appreciative. She'll know what we gave her. And she's the most generous. She will give back to us. Okay? 122. This is an important point. Now here that two things must be regarded concerning our good works, namely our satisfaction and our merit. Okay, satisfaction and merit. Merit is what? Merit is the reward that we will get in heaven for our good actions. It's our crown of glory. So we give that to her. Our satisfaction is what? Our satisfaction is, just to put it very simply, it is the payment of the debt that we owe or someone else owes due to our sins. That is the temporal punishment due to that sin. So what is that? That is basically our time in purgatory. Hopefully, as good Catholics, everybody knows what I'm talking about here. These are like indulgences and our prayers in order to try to make up for our temporal punishment due to sin. Everybody hopefully understands this. If not, it's in the catechism, and you have to do a little homework. So we give that all to her. Now remember, our merits are our own. We can't like apply them to someone else, but our satisfactions we can. So we can give, we can do a rosary for the souls in purgatory, or we can do a plenary indulgence for someone, for a soul in purgatory. We can do a rosary for someone who's alive, if you have a child or something like that, or your sibling. And that's a satisfaction. We do that to help them. It's a little bit more. The example I'm using, a little more than satisfaction, but we can understand that. So we give all that to her. Everything. Okay? That's what he means. Satisfaction and merit. Okay. We no longer have dispose of our good actions, but we still do the things of our state in life. Now, this is a point that everybody gets hung up on. And it's important to properly understand this, because he's going to explain it a little later. Okay. This dependence, though, upon Mary, however, is not without detriment to the duties of a person's present and future state in life. That is, even though we give her everything, that doesn't mean that we just stop praying. It's not like, sometimes I get this question, Father, I've done the consecration to the Montfort, I gave her everything. Now, can I pray for my children? I'm not allowed to pray for my children anymore, am I? No, no. You still pray, you still do your prayers in your state in life. That is your state in life. The place where God has placed you in your life, wherever you are in your life, you still do your prayers within that state. So as a priest, you know, he uses that example. I'll just read it right here, you know. So one such duty, for example, would be a priest who, by virtue of his office or otherwise, must apply a satisfactory prayer or the prayer value of a mass for a particular person. So, as a pastor every week has to pray, has to offer a mass for his parish. That is the parishioners. And that's the pro populo mass you see in the bulletin. He's not saying that, oh, now he's given everything to Mary, he can't do that. No. You do the things in your state in life. There's a mass for a particular person, you know, I still do it. I still pray for, you know, the parish. So also, family, mother and father, still pray within their state in life. They pray for each other, they pray for the children, they pray for their family, they pray for their town, you know, their nation. You still pray. So this is one of the most misunderstood things in the book. And it's, I think, a little bit the way he presents it, because it sounds like we give everything to Mary, and then there's like nothing left. And he'll explain this later. We give everything to Mary, but we still do our prayers in the same way. We still pray. 95% of what we pray for is still going to be the same. And really, the stuff that we're not going to pray for is our selfish prayers then. So if you kind of think about it, you think, well, should I be giving this prayer to Mary? You think, well, no, praying to, you know, win the trip to the Bahamas isn't quite something that I want to give to Mary. It's something I want for myself. And so in a sense, you know, you're not going to pray for that. So in a sense, the devotion helps us to purify our prayers because we're giving them to Mary. And so when we think of it that way, we still pray for the things we're supposed to be praying for. We still do the things we're supposed to do. But he'll explain later on how it is different. So, okay, I'll just leave it at that. I don't want to jump ahead. And we'll explain that later. So, don't get hung up on this. This is another point everybody gets hung up on. The slave thing, and then also this point. Okay, we covered the slave thing last week. Okay. Okay, let's continue. We consecrate ourselves at the same time to both Jesus and Mary. He came to us by her, so we go to her by him. So again, he says there, it does not end with Mary, but it is also, it ends in Christ. Now, this consecration is, he says, a perfect renewal of the baptismal promises. In holy baptism, we do not give ourselves to Jesus explicitly through Mary, nor do we give him the value of our good actions. After baptism, we remain entirely free either to apply the value to anyone we wish or to keep it for ourselves. Now he's explaining how this devotion is a little different than our baptismal promises. But by this consecration, we give ourselves explicitly to Jesus through Mary's hands, and we include in our consecration the value of our actions. Okay. So what's he talking about? The baptismal vows. I've got the baptismal ritual here. Everybody should know these. When we're baptized, if we're a little child, our godparents make the vows for us. If you're an adult, you make them for yourself. And they get renewed on Easter and occasionally other times. And I'll just go through them real quickly. We say, do you renounce Satan? And the person responds, I do renounce him. And all his works, I do renounce him. And all his allurements, I do renounce them. And then we say, do you believe in God, the Father Almighty, the Creator of heaven and earth? I do. Do you believe in Jesus Christ, our only Son, our Lord, who was born into this world and who suffered? I do. Do you believe in the Holy Catholic Church? You believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting? I do. So those are the baptismal vows. In particular, we'll look at the first three wands about renouncing Satan and his works and all his allurements. When we think about it, anytime we commit a sin, we kind of break that vow, don't we? Because we haven't rejected Satan. We haven't rejected his allurement. We gave in to a temptation. And so, what he's saying is those vows are sort of our fundamental practice that we need to preserve. We need to preserve those vows in order to be good Catholics. He says, in a sense, our devotion helps us to fulfill those vows, that is, to reject Satan. Now, he doesn't quite say it this way, but I'm going to say it this way. And that is, again, if we go back to Genesis 3:15, I'll put enmity between you and the woman, between her seed and your seed. If we are consecrating ourselves to Our Lady is the enemy of the devil. So if, in a sense, we are in her camp, in her army, then that is a perfect way in which we can preserve our baptismal vows. Because in our baptismal vows, we reject Satan. We reject him. There's only two camps. There's the camp of Satan, there's the camp of Christ. That's it. Two standards of St. Ignatius of Loyola. And so, by this consecration, we place ourselves under Our Lady. That is, we can think of her as the leader of the heavenly forces. So in that way, we reject Satan. And in that way, then, it is a perfect renewal of our baptismal vows. It's a different way of looking at it. He presents it a little differently, but this is essentially what he's saying. Okay. Now, he goes into some objections to this. Paragraph 132, to the perfect devotion to Our Lady, that is, giving her everything. 132. Some may object that this devotion makes us powerless to help the souls of our relatives, friends, benefactors, since it requires us to give our Lord, through Mary, the value of all our good works, prayers, and penances, and almsgiving. Okay. Now, I said, first of all, we don't want to get hung up on that. That's wrong to say that we are powerless to help them. And he says, it is inconceivable that our friends and relatives should suffer any loss because we have dedicated and consecrated ourselves unconditionally to service of Jesus and Mary. Mary will surely come to the aid of our relatives, friends and benefactors, whether from our spiritual assets or from others. So remember, Our Lady has everything. So maybe we have a friend who is in need of help. Our prayers aren't enough to help them. So Our Lady will then come to help them with her entire treasury of graces to help them. So he's saying, don't worry about it. Just pray in the state of life, and Our Lady will take care of it. And then again, this devotion does not prevent us from praying for others, both the living and the dead. Okay, I've covered that enough. Paragraph 133. Some may say, perhaps, if I give Our Lady the full value of my actions to apply to whom she will, I may have to suffer a long time in purgatory because I need that satisfaction and I've given it all away. And of course, this objection, which arises out of self-love, from an unawareness of generosity of God and our Holy Mother, refutes itself. If we give everything, Our Lady will not leave us in purgatory. She will apply what is needed to get us out of purgatory. Okay. So, here we go. Jesus and Mary never let themselves to be outdone in generosity. And so, with that, it's getting late. So, that's the end of chapter 3. He does give us a little segue into chapter 4, which is next time we will consider the motives which commend this devotion to us and its wonderful effects it produces in the soul and the practices of this devotion. So, he's finally, in chapter 3, told us what the devotion is, taking two chapters to prepare us for it. And when we really reflect on it, it's pretty serious. Some people, as he says, are going to reject this. They're not going to be interested in this. They're going to think it's crazy. And they're going to want to have nothing to do with this. Others who will understand it will only take tentative steps towards it. It says they will come to the threshold but will not enter in. They cannot let go of their things, their satisfactions and merits. But then he says there will be a few who actually enter in. So, it's a good meditation. We can think about these things. And if you don't understand it, you can pray to Our Lady that she'll give you an understanding. So, we will meet next week. Begin chapter 4. Continue to go through the booklet. Even if you've messed up, missed a day or two, just do it. If you've done it before, just do it. Just do it. Get the consecration done. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen.